Welcome back. So, in the last class, I started giving you some historical perspectives of NMR spectroscopy and gave you some information about its utility in various branches of science. And I also mentioned the names of the pioneers who contributed significantly, many Nobel laureates, for this NMR spectroscopy. Of course, we have to know that. So we should know who are the pioneers who made NMR what it is today. So that's what we discussed. And also, I discussed about spin angular momentum and how we can get empirically by knowing atomic mass and atomic number. What we will do is, today, we'll continue further and see how we can arrive at the value of the nuclear spin based on the alignment of protons and neutrons within the nucleus. Of course, empirical rule is one way. Just to make you familiar, you should know how we can get. If I say it is half, just because I know atomic mass and atomic number, we can work out. But there is way to get it also, in a different way. If I take proton, it has a single proton, means hydrogen atom. Please remember, in NMR jargon, when we say it is a hydrogen atom, we colloquially say it is a proton. Means not we are talking about the proton of the nucleus. Of course, that's what we are mentioning. That's what we are referring to. But colloquially, if there is a hydrogen atom in a molecule, we say we are dealing with protons. That means there is only one proton in it. And it is a practice, colloquially we say, for hydrogen atom, it is a proton. So if you look at hydrogen atom, it has a single proton in the nucleus. What is the spin of proton, I said? It is half. So no question of any discussion on that. It is only one proton. It is established experimentally. Its spin is half. Now let us take deuterium. It has single proton and single neutron. There is no pairing. Both of them are not paired. They're single. Each of them are unpaired spins, like proton and neutron. They're unpaired. Each of them are single. And each has spin half. Now, combine this. What is the total nuclear spin of deuterium? 2 into half. Each of them have spin half. So, 2 into half, it is 1. Because I am just taking together the total spin. So, it is 1. So, spin of the deuterium is 1. Now, let us look at what is the spin of boron 10. See, atomic mass is 10, but atomic number is 5. So, in the atomic mass, in the nucleus of the boron 10, we have 5 protons and 5 neutrons. Both are odd numbers. Now, let us see what is the configuration, how they get paired. Of course, it is similar to your atomic theory, where you can find out how the electrons are paired, etc. You know, you all know atomic theory, exactly similar to that. Of course, more details are there. I'm not going to the details, for which you need to understand a lot more about nuclear physics. But simply, I'm giving you how you have to find out the configurations. From the configuration, how you'll arrive at the spin. The proton configuration is given like this. There are 5 protons, first 2 are paired, remaining 3 are unpaired. Why they are unpaired, why these 2 are paired, why they are unpaired, more details you can see in the nuclear physics. Okay, no problem, but you just take my word. Similarly, neutron, 5 neutrons are there, odd number, first 2 are paired, 3 are unpaired. So, what is the total spin of boron? 6 into half, they are unpaired remains. You have to always count unpaired spins, you know, unpaired protons, unpaired neutrons, you have to take into account and then work out the total nuclear spins. So, 3 unpaired protons, 3 unpaired neutrons, together there are 6, and total spin of each of them is spin half, So total spin is 3. So boron 10 has spin 3. It is an integer number. That's what you can get from your table which I gave earlier. And for determining the nuclear spin, you can say boron 11 will go. It is the other isotope of boron. There are 5 protons and 6 neutrons. Neutrons are completely paired. They are even number. Proton configuration is, of course, we saw in the previous example, 2 are paired, 3 are unpaired. So, as far as the neutrons are concerned, completely they are paired. We don't have to worry. Now, there are 3 unpaired protons. As a consequence, boron 11 nuclear spin is 3 into half. It is 3 by 2. See, boron 10 is spin 3, boron 11 is spin 3 by 2. What you could get from that table which I gave you by an empirical rule. Now, carbon 12 we will see. Is another thing, we always say carbon 12 spin is 0. That's what we saw. They both are even number. Atomic mass and atomic number both are even. The spin of carbon 12 is 0. Why? Look at this one. Both of them have 6 protons and 6 neutrons. They are completely paired. There is no unpaired proton in the configuration. Proton pairing configuration, if you see, there is no unpaired proton. Similarly, there is no unpaired neutron. All protons and neutrons are completely paired. So what is the total spin of carbon 12? 0. There is no unpaired proton or unpaired neutron. Nitrogen 14. I'm giving you another one example to make you more familiar. 7 protons and 7 neutrons. Both are odd numbers. Now let us see the configuration. Proton configuration, 6 of them are paired. Only 1 proton is unpaired. Similarly, neutron configurations, 6 are paired, 1 is unpaired. So how many are unpaired in the nucleus? 1 proton and 1 neutron. Now, if you take this thing together, for the 2 unpaired, 1 proton, 1 neutron, the total spin of nitrogen 14 is 1. Spin of N14 is 1. With that, of course, I gave you some examples to work out. Do this exercise. Take any isotope of an element in the periodic table. Of course, don't go to a bigger one because then your configuration, you have to start working out. It is going to be a huge exercise. Something simple you can take, like silicon or lithium, like that. Find out what is the spin of lithium. Okay, lithium 6 and lithium 7 by this configuration. How they get aligned. You will know. You can use the table to find out, or you can also use the method of configuration, how they get paired to get the spin of the nuclear. Fine. That is important concept to understand. Now, if you have to understand NMR spectroscopy, you must know basics of NMR physics. Without that, you will not understand NMR. But you need to understand some mathematics, some spin physics. But I'll try to minimize the mathematics as much as possible. I will not frighten you by giving high funda mathematics, high level mathematics. But whatever is required basically, I will make it as simple as possible to carry all of you with me. But these are the important concepts you must know if you know NMR spectroscopy. Now, if I look at the angular momentum p, which is represented as p of the nucleus, there are 2 quantum numbers associated with that. For the nucleus, if we have a spin angular momentum p, there are 2 quantum numbers associated with that. And these 2 quantum numbers define its properties of this angular momentum. Remember, for this nucleus, spin angular momentum, if it is there, it is associated with 2 quantum numbers. These 2 quantum numbers define the properties of this P. Okay, what are they? One is a spin quantum number I. Okay, and all the nuclei with spin angular momentum have a magnetic moment also. This is a spin quantum number. That is one of the quantum number of the 2. Second, remember, all the angular spin angular momentum of all the nuclei also have magnetic moment. Again, it is a vector which has a magnitude and direction, and the magnitude is constant and direction is also defined. We can define the direction. What is this? This is magnetic quantum number given by M, and M is related to I. If I know spin quantum number I know what is magnetic quantum number M. That is why I have written as M subscript I. Please remember, spin angular momentum P of the nucleus is associated with these two quantum numbers, spin quantum number I and magnetic quantum number M, which depends upon what is I. And these two numbers will define the properties of angular momentum. Okay. Now, let us look at nucleus with spin quantum number I. When I say it has a magnetic moment, we can say, we should understand what does it imply. What do you mean by telling a material has a magnetic moment? Nucleus with spin quantum number I has a magnetic moment. It implies that nuclear spins behave like a tiny magnet. You know that when you have a magnet, we can get magnetic moment. You understand? So it implies to me, if I say any nucleus has spin I, it also has magnetic moment M. As a consequence, we can say all the nuclear spins behave like a tiny magnet. Every nuclear spin is a tiny magnet. Imagine if I take small amount of sample to study NMR in the NMR tube. Let us say 1 mL, you can find out how many atoms are there in a given this thing by using Avogadro number. And each of them has so many tiny magnets. Remember, millions and millions of tiny magnets will be there, because we can treat every nuclear spin as a tiny magnet. Okay. Sorry. Next. What is the magnitude of this nuclear spin angular momentum? I said nuclear spin angular momentum. It has a magnitude also. What is the magnitude of the spin angular momentum? That is given by spin quantum number I. Because it's, as I said, its properties is decided by two quantum numbers, I and M, magnetic quantum number, I said. That's what I said, right? Now, if I want to find out the magnitude of this P, it is given by this expression, H cross into square root of I into I plus 1. Now, what is I? What is H cross? H cross is, of course, nothing but Planck's constant. You all know H divided by 2 pi. Planck's constant divided by 2 pi is called H cross. That is put here. So P is the angular momentum. Its magnitude is given by this. I is the spin quantum number. All are known now. That you don't have to get confused. All these properties, all these parameters P, I, everything is known. Another thing we say in quantum mechanics, the component of angular momentum along the axis of a magnetic field Z is governed by magnetic quantum number M. You see, it is angular momentum is again a vector quantity. It always gets quantized along a particular direction in a magnetic field. I am taking the PZ direction, quantized direction. And magnetic, it is Z component of this PZ is given by what is called M H cross. What is M? M is the magnetic quantum number. I remember I told you already. M is a magnetic quantum number which depends upon I. That's what I wrote MI. So I total the Z component of the angular momentum depends upon M, and it is given as PZ equal to M H cross. All those things you can derive, but you remember, there is no need to go into the more details. That this is a concept you must know. The Z component of the angular momentum, that is along the direction of the magnetic field PZ, is given as MH cross. Now, The magnetic quantum number m, I said, depends upon I. How does it depend upon I? There is very well-established rule given. The magnetic quantum number m always takes the value of I from minus I to plus I, incremented in steps of 1. Please understand. If I know I, that is a spin quantum number. For example, spin quantum number of proton is half. What is minus I is half. Then minus I, minus half to plus I, plus half. So it will go from minus half to plus half in steps of 1. The magnetic quantum number m depends upon I, which can go from minus I to plus I in steps of 1. So as a consequence, how many orientations are possible? There are 2i plus n possible orientations. Okay? If I want to find out what is the magnetic quantum number m, which I said mi, that it defines the orientations of m based on I, there are totally 2i plus n orientations possible for any given spin I. Okay? The z component of the spin angular momentum means is always quantized in a given magnetic field B naught. So that's what I said. Z component is quantized. It is not continuous, it is discrete, it is in quantized, discrete quantized there. And these directions are defined by the number of orientations are given by mi, which goes from minus I to plus I in steps of 1. Okay. Now, what are the possible orientations we can think of for angular momentum P for different spin quantum number I? We'll take examples. I'm talking about I, spin of the nucleus, and angular momentum P is there. And we found out what are the possible orientations. The angular momentum orientations, possible orientations is given by I, which are nothing but mi. So now, for spin half nuclei, there are two orientations. Minus half and plus half goes in steps of 1. If you take minus half and then add 1, you will get plus half. So only there are two quantization directions. There are only two orientations. For spin half, there are only two quantization directions. For spin 1, there are three quantization directions. Because start with minus I, this is, I is 1, that is minus 1. Add 1, 0. Add 1, it is 1. So from minus I to plus I, there are only three orientations for spin 1 nuclei. There are three quantization directions. For spin 3 by 2, there are four orientations. Starts with minus I, minus 3 by 2, then add 1, it will become minus half, plus half, and plus 3 by 2. There are four possible quantization directions, four possible orientations for angular momentum, which is quantized along z axis. You can work out like this for any spin quantum number I of the nucleus. So the quantization directions we understood. This is spin of nuclei 2. Then what is the quantization direction? And I say there are two possible orientation, which has directions, two quantization directions. What are these? What do you mean by plus half direction? What do you mean by minus half directions? This is for positive value of mi, that is positive value of half. The spin angular momentum orients in the direction of the field. And this spin angular momentum orients in the direction of the field. For spin angular momentum, which is for negative values of mi, so positive value of mi, it is in the direction of the field. The same thing when it is negative, it is in the direction opposite to the magnetic field. There are two orientations for spin off. This way and this way. Remember, this concept, we'll be using it very often to understand the degeneracy of the spin system, etc., as we go ahead. Okay. So, for spin off nuclei, there are two possible quantization directions of mi, plus half in this direction this is the direction of the magnetic field. Let us say I take z-axis as the direction of the magnetic field. So one of the orientation direction is in the direction of the field. Other quantization direction is in the direction opposite to the field. That's what, please remember. And the one which is in the direction of the field is called spin up. And the other one is called spin down. There are two orientations, spin up and spin down. They are also represented as plus half and minus half states. So spin half has two possible quantization states. Okay, two possible orientations along z direction. So they are plus half and minus half, spin up and spin down states. And colloquially or conventionally, in NMR jargon, spin up state is defined as alpha and spin down state is denoted as beta. Please remember, alpha and beta are spin up and spin down states. Nothing but plus half and minus half states. Is it clear? The two spin states of spin half nuclei are plus half and minus half. This is spin up and spin down, or alpha state or beta state. These are the terminologies which are routinely used. Now let us calculate the direction of orientation and magnitude of the spin angular momentum for a spin half nucleus. I said it is quantized and I have two directions. Spin angular momentum, I said z component is quantized and it is given by mh cross. We remember I wrote an equation, pz is equal to mh cross. What is m? M is equal to m depends upon I, plus I to minus I. There are, so for spin half nuclei, we have two orientations, minus half and plus half. Now, let us find out the orientation direction and its magnitude. And I said it orients in the direction of the field, in the direction opposite to the field, but does not necessarily mean always perfectly aligned along the field. In fact, although we say in the direction of the field, it is making an angle theta. The orientation, the direction of orientation of this component plus this magnetic moment, this angular momentum along this two quantization directions, they make an angle theta. What is this angle theta? You can find out. I know this, PZ, because this I know as MH cross, and I also know P is equal to H cross into root into I plus 1 that I mentioned earlier. I is spin half. I know H cross. I can calculate what is P. I know PZ because equal to MH cross. M is equal to minus half and plus half are the only two orientations because it depends upon I. Now I can calculate theta. For that I must know what is this. Or I don't need to know. If I know this and this also, I can calculate theta. Similarly, I can calculate theta for this orientation. And there is no difference between theta, this and this. One is this is theta positive, this is negative. This orients in the direction opposite to field. By the same angle, it orients in the direction of the field. So you can find out the angle theta, the direction of orientation. Let us do that. Okay. For m half, find out cos theta is equal to mh cross over h cross into root of I into I plus 1. Go back here. Cosine of the angle theta is given by this side. By this side is a trigonometry right angle triangle I am using. Okay, that is the idea. So I know cosine of the angle theta is given by this. What is the value of m? Half. For m half, m is equal to half. What is I? H cross and H cross here. See, this H cross and this H cross gets cancelled out. So you are left with M. M is equal to half. I is equal to half. So it turns out to be half over square root of 3 by 4. This is simple numbers. Plug it into your calculator. You get cosine of theta. Now find out cos inverse of that. It turns out to be theta is equal to 54.7 degrees. Please remember, theta is 54.7 degrees. Same way, for m equal to minus half, it is 54.7 degree in the direction opposite to z-axis. So, the one of the orientation of the spin angular momentum, one component of it, in the direction of the field, correspond to theta equal to 54.7, other is same angle in the direction opposite to this thing. So, these are the two orientations. This one is plus 54.7, this is minus 54.7 with respect to this one. Okay, this is what it is. We can work it out and we got this. So, two angles we know, we understood the magnitude also. We calculated magnitude and magnitude is given by this and we also know what is the angle theta. Now, what is the quantization direction for spin 1 nuclei? Can you understand? Why not? The spin 1, for spin 1 nuclei, m can take 3 values, minus 1, 0 and plus 1. So, what are the quantization directions? 3 like this. We know pz equal to mh cross, m is equal to minus 1, so minus h cross, m equal to 0, so pz equal to 0 here, m is equal to plus 1, pz equal to h cross. Now, calculate the angle theta here, this is 0, is 90 degree with respect to magnetic field, this is theta. Now, simply plug in these values. Cosine of theta for m is equal to 1, again, in this case also, you take out this one. I'm sorry. Again, this h cross, this h cross gets cancelled out. You are leaving, left with m, which is 1, I into I plus 1, which is half into half plus 1. Okay. Half into half plus 1. Half plus 1 is 3 by 4. Oh, so there is some mistake I made here. Okay. So you can find out. So this should be 3 by 4. Okay, there is a mistake. Anyway, please note, this is not half, this is I into I plus 1, this has to be 3 by 4. Okay, plug in these values. I have written wrong here, but I have correctly calculated the angle by plugging into the calculator. So, this turns out to be theta for this is 45 degrees and with respect to plus z-axis, this is 45, this is 45 with respect to minus z-axis. So, you calculate the angle theta for plus 1, 0 and minus 1 states. Now, same way, work out the quantization direction for spin 3 by 2 nuclei. There are only 4 possible quantization directions. Minus 3 by 2, minus half, plus half and plus 3 by 2. Again, I don't want to go into the details of that. Okay. Okay, plug in these values and then what is m is equal to 3 by 2, it is 3 by 2 into 3 by 2 plus 1, find out this value number, put plug this into calculator, find out theta. Now theta values for this are 39.23, for this is 39.23 in the direction of the field, in the direction opposite to the field. Of course, for these two we have already worked out, plus half and minus half, it is 54.7. both in the direction of the field, in the direction opposite to field. So, that's what we have worked out. So, now we can get magnitude and the direction of orientations of all these vectors, all this. Okay. So, now the next question is, we have to understand another term I want to introduce called nuclear magnetic moment. Well, if I start discussing about this nuclear magnetic moment, I think it will. I have to take a lot of time. I cannot stop in between. So what I am going to do is, I will stop for the day. I have already introduced to you a lot of things today about the spin angular momentum, direction of their quantization, how do you get their angle, how do you get their magnitude, etc. And what are the directions of orientations of for spin half nuclei, spin 1 nuclei and spin 3 by 2 nuclei. We calculated the angle theta and magnitude, everything. Please remember these things. These are all important from the basic conceptual understanding of NMR. The spin physics is a little bit is important. And I also said, for spin angular momentum I, P, we have two quantum numbers, I and M. M depends upon I, this is MI, goes from minus I to plus I. So based on that, the Z component of the angular momentum P, which is quantized along Z axis, is given as PZ is equal to MH cross. M values are known. Accordingly, we calculated everything. This is the summary of what I said for today, in gist, in one or two sentences. We'll continue further with some more concept called magnetic moment, which is also essential. And then we continue further about more understanding of the concepts in from the next class.